Hey everyone, and welcome to another 5-minute challenge, a bite-sized tip with a splash of creativity to get you designing and thinking outside the box. Today we're going to be taking to the web and building out a simple but flashy landing page using Adobe XD. Be sure to stick around to the end to find out how you can get your work featured in a future video and a few highlights from the past challenge. What's a landing page without a full-width image? With the rectangle tool, draw one out across the entire artboard, which in this project is 1920 by 1080. With that in place, we need a photo. Hopping over to Finder, I have a great shot of Japan that I'll drag right onto the rectangle. And just to focus it up a touch, I'll double-click to scale and reposition. Next up, we need some headers. With the text tool, type out a catchy title that relates to the location of the photo. And for maximum impact, choose a large font with a color that stands out against the background. Now, to add a bit more context, a subheader can be quickly added by duplicating the larger one and dropping the size by pulling on the handle. For this, I'll add in a few cities in Japan that I'm dying to visit. Against this particular image, positioning the text towards the bottom left corner looks pretty nice, but feel free to move it around to find the optimal location. At the top of this page, we may want a navigation bar and a bold call to action to book a trip. With another rectangle, I'll draw one out, leaving a bit of room on the sides. White should do for now. I can now quickly duplicate this rectangle with Command or Control D, and then reduce this one in size to use for the button. Since this should be eye-catching, a vibrant color will surely do the job. Great, let's throw in some additional text. For the call to action, I'm going to use the same typeface as the header, with a nice bold weight. To help you out with elements like this, you can place the text and background shape in a group or component, and then turn on padding within the Properties Inspector. Now, with the text right justified, the container will automatically resize if you need to change the label. Next, over to the left, we need a logo and some links. Instead of an icon-based logo, I'm going to use the kanji characters for Japan, and I'll sample a dark blue from the mountains. As for the links, 4 should work, and instead of the uppercase typeface I've been using, I'll switch it up to one that's somewhat condensed. Now I can either use a repeat grid if the labels are going to be around the same length, or the distribution options. With all 4 text layers created, I'll select them all, and the logo, then press the Distribute Horizontally button to ensure they're all spaced evenly from each other. Finally, to complete this navigation area, I may want to introduce a bit of color to the white bar. And to do that, a very subtle background blur can be added, with the amount value cranked all the way up, and the brightness set pretty high so that just a touch of the background seeps through. Wonderful, that's looking pretty good, but before we move on, I'm going to quickly group and organize my elements to keep the project nice and tidy. The final feature of this landing page I want to touch on is a clickable image gallery, and for that, we're going to be using components. At the bottom right corner of the page, I'm going to start by drawing out a rectangle that will allow us to click over to another image, and I'll add another background blur to the shape, but quite a bit darker than the navigation bar. With that in place, we need an arrow. You can either create one using the pen tool, or bring one in from a plugin or icon set. I'll quickly grab one from the Icons for Design plugin, enlarge it, then change the color to white. Great. Now to create the component, we'll want to select not only the navigation arrows, but the background image as well. The plus button within your Properties Inspector or Assets panel will let you create the component, and if during the creation it moves up in the layer stack, bring it back down behind all the other elements. We can then create an additional state, which will allow us to transition to another image. All we need to do now is select the background layer, switch back over to Finder, and drag a new image in, and you can repeat the process to add as many images as you wish. If you find that the blurs aren't interacting well with the background, you can tweak them on a state-by-state basis, or edit the default to change them all at once. With that in place, let's wire it up. Hopping into prototype mode, I'll select the arrow that I want to transition to the other state, and then single-click on the blue handle. This will then let me select the destination state within the properties. As for the action, there isn't much to animate here, but we may want a nice fade between the images. So I'll go with a transition with the animation set to dissolve, and a duration of around 0.8 seconds. I can then add additional interactions on the other states leading to any other images I may have within this component. And when the prototype is launched, we can cycle through the beautiful gallery. Now it's your turn. Take what you picked up in the last few minutes and get creative. Make sure to share your work on our Discord server or on Twitter using the hashtag XDChallenge, and we'll highlight a few in a future video. And if you're itching for more, we do run daily challenges on Behance, so be sure to check those out as well. Thanks so much for hanging out, everyone, and I'll see you all next time.